Hello? Hey, can you hear me now? I feel like the Verizon commercial. Can you? Good morning and welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Wayne County. I am your worship associate this morning and my name is Laura Grimm. We are a diverse congregation that welcomes you as you are, regardless of your age, ethnicity, race, sexual orientation, gender identity, economic status, or physical ability. We come together to seek deeper meaning and an understanding from each other and the world around us. Your presence here today is a gift that brings us closer to that understanding. We are an active community that lives its values beyond the hours of Sunday service, and I'd like to call your attention to the following. Please join us this Tuesday for the vegan potluck. It's at 6:15. Please bring a vegan dish to share. Also bring plates and silverware and that sort of thing. Reach out to Karen Armstrong with any questions. And I don't see Karen. Next Tuesday. My bad. July 23rd. Please take a look at the back of your order of service for more information regarding events and activities occurring at our fellowship. If you would like to find out more about our activities, please feel free to ask Karen Skubik, our membership coordinator.
Thank you, Laura, and I'd also like to welcome everybody and say good morning. I wasn't here last week, and I missed all of you, but I really enjoyed hearing Gail talking about community, and that's kind of what my job is about and the membership committee, so it's so good to see my community, and I hope a lot of you feel like this is your community. If you don't, let us know how we can get you involved if you'd like to be involved and feel like this is community, because that really, like Gail said, really is a lot of what it's all about here. And I'll be at the back of the sanctuary after the service if anyone wants to talk to me. Good to see you all.
I'd like to welcome you all here today again on this beautiful day when I'm sure you had other things that you could be doing, like, you know, sitting by the pool, being in the pool, finding some nice cool air conditioning somewhere. But that's what makes this place great, is because we are community, and we're going to have part two of that sermon in just a little bit. But I want to welcome you all today. I'm glad you're here, and I'm glad to see your smiling faces. And so at this point in time, we're going to ask you to turn off your electronic devices and put them in worship mode. And go ahead and listen to the prelude. Thank you.
our chalice lighting this morning as we gather here as individual people by Reverend Barbara Hamilton Holloway. We gather here as individual people, young and old, male and female, temporarily able and disabled, gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender, and straight people, all the colors of the human race, theist, atheist, agnostic, Christian, Buddhist, feminist, humanist. We gather here as a community of people who are more than categories. We gather here each ministering to the other, meeting one another's strength, encouraging wholeness. We give thanks for this extraordinary blessing, the gathering together of separate, unique individuals as one whole, one body, our church. Here may our minds stretch, our hearts open, our spirits deepen. May we acknowledge our brokenness and be ever stirred by love's infinite possibilities. Come, let us worship. Now let us rise in body or spirit as we sing our opening hymn, number 168 in the gray hymnal, One More Step.
Take time out of each service for a little bit of quiet meditation. And I think it's important to do this because it seems to center us. So I'm going to ask you to close your eyes. Don't go to sleep. I know when you snore. Put your feet flat on the floor, please, and your hands in your lap. Take in a big, deep breath and exhale. Feel those shoulders come down below your ears and feel your body relax. Take one more deep breath, and as you exhale, let the problems and sorrows you may have be expelled into this space and dissipate and leave you with calmness. As you center yourself in this sacred space, we're going to observe a few moments of silence. I'll use this one. We would like to take this time to please send healing energy to Mary Wick's sister, Liz Burrows. She will be having a mastectomy on July 16th. And as we know, that is not a pleasant surgery. And also, Skip and Letty Nault let us know that they're going to be moving to Danbury. So let's pull together, let's give them all the help that they need so that their transition is as easy as possible. Now, if you have sorrows you would like to expel, please come to the table, take a stone from the bowl, and place it in the water. And as we do this, we will sing our meditative hymn, Spirit of Life, number 123. I didn't talk about any joys today. And there is a joy, well, one of them's there and one of them's over there, and they're married for 45 years today. Jim and Inez Bird. And why they're over there, I don't know. But anyway.
Our faith is centered on the belief that we can make the world a better place for all who dwell in it. In order to realize that vision, we need both the motivation and the means. Your donation helps the community build, put its faith into action by supporting our programming and facilities. This morning and throughout the month of July, donations that are not designated for another purpose will be split with the Worcester Hope Center. The Worcester Hope Center provides food, clothing, haircuts, and hygiene products to over 3,500 people, 3,500 families in the Wayne County area. The offering will now be taken and gratefully accepted. Thank you. To dedicate this morning's offering, please join me in this unison reading. The words are on the screen. Let us be grateful when we are able to give, for many do not have that privilege. Let us be grateful for those who share their gifts with us, for we are enriched by their giving. Let us be grateful even for our needs, so that we may learn from the generosity of others. Our reading this morning is about multi-generational congregations. What would a truly multi-generational congregation look like? Reverend Judith A. Freudian says it would be the ultimate committee of the whole, a community in which everyone is seen as a teacher and learner, in which every age and stage of life is equally valued and equally supported by whatever tangible and intangible resources the community has to offer, in which every age and stage of life is allowed to contribute whatever tangible and intangible resources it has to offer. A community in which no decision is made about the life of the community, whether in the area of worship, physical plant, fundraising, budgeting, social action, the arts, education, or any other, without consideration of its impact on and opportunities for every member of the community. What does a multi-generational congregation look like? Reverend Linda Olson Peebles says, every age group is a participant, leader, and recipient of every part of the church. For example, worship for all ages, pastoral care for all ages, social justice for and with all ages, governances including all ages, learning happening with many ages together, both as teachers and learners. At the same time, each generation is empowered, honored, and uniquely served. In other words, there are still programs and ministry unique for each generation. The norm is a room filled with people of all ages who choose to be there because of a shared interest, such as singing, cooking, talking about books, planning for a fundraiser, talking about who to hire, or selecting good community building games to play. Age-based groups can also form alongside these multi-generational activities in order to meet specific needs or interests.
You're all here because you want to be. No one twisted your arm. No one made you feel guilty and said you have to be here or else. No one did that. You're here because you want to be. You're here in community. And last week, we talked about some of the history around building community and how numerous women went to the Midwest and formed Unitarian churches in Iowa and Minnesota, North and South Dakota, Indiana, and Ohio. They were very busy. We also talked about a man from Transylvania who, through all of his toil and his trouble and imprisonment and labor camps, took the time in the most dire of circumstances to build a community in a punishment camp full of political prisoners. And today, I want to discuss ways that we can keep our community strong and even strengthen it in the future. So last week, I gave you all some homework. And you responded. You responded via email. You responded via text. And I have those with me today. And I've made a note of those, and we're going to talk about those briefly.
And another thing that keeps us strong is participating in discussions, as one of the readings said. Participate in discussions during the service. We are free to talk about our suggestions, our opinions, and how it may be good for us. Now, I may not read all the suggestions that came in because some would need to go directly to either the minister or to membership, but here are some of the things that you had asked for. Monthly potlucks were suggested twice by two different people. Sitting down with people and breaking bread, as it were, and sharing a meal tends to break the ice, especially with a lot of the new folks. So that was one thing that was brought up. Another thing that was brought up was more lay-led services and bringing back steps to the meeting house. That was mentioned three times. Now, you've seen me 2 weeks in a row, and I'm sure you've had enough of lay-led services for a bit. So we'll just go past that. But learning more about the people's journey to our fellowship, I think, is really important. It lets us get to know one another better. It lets us get to know your backgrounds better and where you came from. And now you're here, and where are you going? And I think it's very, very important. So I'm going to strongly urge our minister to bring that back at least twice a year. Movie night. Movie night for all ages, pizzas, who knows, games, board games, multi-generational transactions, as the reading said, I think are important. And this too was suggested twice. A craft night. Everybody getting together to do the same craft. The older of us helping the younger of us with these things, or better still, the younger of those folks helping us older folks figure out what this craft is about. It can be a learning experience all the way around. An example was given, for example, for Valentine's Day. Let's have a cupcake decorating night, and we'll serve those cupcakes at the service the following Sunday. They don't have to be beautiful, they just have to be done, and everybody will have fun doing it. Host a blood drive. I don't think we've ever done that here, and that is a very, very good idea. The Red Cross is always looking for places.
We have had a blood drive.
Oh. And how was it?
The turnout was not way up there like they would like.
Okay. If we want to do that again, we have to make sure that people are going to show. And I think that's important. Not only friends, but neighbors and those folks who give on a routine basis. And we can contact other churches to let them know what's happening to get more in here for the Red Cross. Summertime is a crucial time for the Red Cross, by the way, being kind of tangent to that field in the laboratory business. But summer is always busy because people don't donate as much in the summer, and we have more accidents that happen in the summer and more need for blood products. Secret Pals, where an adult is matched up with one of the RE kids. They write letters for about 3 months. The RE kid doesn't know who the adult is, and the adult doesn't know, outside of the age and gender, who the RE kid is. And I think this is a wonderful idea. I think it would be great to continue our multi-generational situation. We can also identify what someone called communication experts, who can move among the congregation and promote the inclusion of new people into the groups we've already put together. A lot of us sit together, you know, and it's hard sometimes for new folks to break into those groups. So why not have that connection where someone who is very familiar with the congregation could do that? Another thing that came up and was mentioned two different times, any group of people if there's more than one person in a group, we're going to have disagreements. And if you've got one person in a group and they're having disagreements with themselves, then I think they need more help than we can give them. That's just my opinion. But we're going to have disagreements. And rather than go to your friends and whisper in their ear about the disagreement you may be having with him or her or whoever, why can't we just sit down and talk about it? All of our problems can be solved by discussion. Personalities are made up of opinions. So any disagreement is simply a difference of opinion. And we can value that, we can respect that. But talking about it, I think, is an important goal that we can have here. And there are always those of us who are willing and able to set in as kind of a mediator to help with this and bring the issue to a conclusion. And I think we're strong enough to covenant to do those kind of things. The minister can also act as a facilitator. Working together for a common goal was another one that was brought up. Soup kitchens, roadside cleanup, after-school tutoring, group volunteering at people-to-people, playing games at a retirement center. Those were all things that were brought up. And everybody's smiling and nodding their head and thinking it's a good idea. And those were some of the ones that were sent to us. Now, Juan and Bonnie, if you could take the microphones, please. I'm going to ask you now if you have any more suggestions. And as you give them to me, I am going to write them down. Show of hands. Come on, folks. Put on the thinking caps. Sue has one.
Just to add that there are a group of six or seven of us that work at Trinity Breakfast during the week.
That's Trinity UCC. That's for the breakfast. Yes. And you work there what day?
Thursday.
Thursday. So any of you who would like to help, that would be a wonderful group activity. And what time do you normally meet there?
7.
7 a.m. I know that's early for a lot of us.
And some UUs are there on Tuesday.
And some are there on Tuesday also, the same time?
Yes.
Okay.
I want to say thank you, Gail, for this list. I've been writing it down, too. And I'm looking at Laura, our membership chair, and we've come up with a number of these ideas. And what I would love of any new ideas that come out now or the ones that you know of is to someone to take the lead on some of these, because the membership committee does do a lot, and we could even use more people on the membership committee who would like to lead any of these things. But if you would like to take leadership in any of these initiatives, please let me know, or Gail know, or Laura, and we'd love to start any of these ideas. Thank you.
I will also, when we're finished this morning, I'm going to make sure there's a complete list of all the things we talked about. And I will send copies to the appropriate committees and the minister, and because some of those will be on to him, and especially the steps to the meeting house one will be on the minister. And that way, these can go to the committee, or if you guys want to help with some of this stuff, let Karen know, okay? She'll make sure that she gets you directed to the right area. All right, any other suggestions?
They have a sing-along at the SI usually, like a circle sing, and we used to do that here. I think that would be great to start up again.
Mine isn't a request. I mean, mine is a request, not a suggestion. And that is that you not only send that to appropriate committees, but send that whole list out to the congregation so we can look at it more carefully and see where we might want to say, oh, I'd like to link up with that.
idea.
We also have Cakes for Kids, which is whenever there's a birthday at 180, they let me know. And we have a small group of volunteers that do the birthday cakes for the kids and the moms at 180, and they love it.
They do love getting their cakes. They do.
So I grew up in a Unitarian fellowship in Poughkeepsie, New York, and they would have once a month an artist rotation where members could put up their artwork, and it was in the kind of in the coffee main area. And so there was it was a rotating thing. So every month it was, you could do poetry or artwork, but it was member done, and that would be neat.
It's a very good idea.
Yeah.
Because we have a lot of talented people in this congregation, and there's some amazing stuff out there. Good idea. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm just a visitor here, but I attend a church down in Florida. One of the things that we're active in is providing food, backpacks for kids with food for the weekends when they don't have food. And we support about 150 kids every week with food.
Wait.
Hang on. Hold on. We can't hear you.
I was going to say something along those lines of this gentleman, something for the preparedness of the children going back to school. Maybe we could have a drive maybe at the end of fall or at the end of summer. We could bring little crayons and pencils and this, that, and the other thing, glue and rulers and so on and so forth, donate them to the...
I just had a thought, too, as she was talking about that. So many kids going back to school, they're required to buy a certain amount of things. Yet, that never covers everything. And I know that teachers put their own money into buying supplies and this type of thing. Wouldn't it be nice if we could help out some of those teachers with a gift card of some type, so not all of the funds are coming out of their own pocket? Just a thought.
Along that same line, the city is opening a new warming center, and it will be a permanent place where people can have housing, and there will be beds for males, females, but everything else is going to be on a volunteer basis. They're going to need towels, they're going to need washcloths, they're going to need soap, toothpaste, toothbrushes, all kinds of things. I made a list which I have given to the minister, and hopefully this center will be open in November.
Excellent idea. Thank you.
More fellowship members going to Summer Institute, which is going to be at Oberlin College next year.
They say there's Summer Institute magic. That's kind of a nebulous kind of word, but it is very inspiring, very uplifting, and it can get you through the rest of the year if you don't have the life that you want. The love, the community, the compassion that's in that group is absolutely wonderful. New friends are made, bonds, you get to know more about the various churches. And there's one faction that joined us last year because they lost their venue for their summer institute. And with us moving to Oberlin, they didn't think they were able to come because they come from the eastern area, and they are coming. Their youth pushed and said, we're going, you guys can do what you want. So they are going to buses, RVs, vans, whatever, to get them over because they felt that SI had taken them in so beautifully and taught them so much. So it was a good thing.
Gail, I'm wondering if some of the ideas that people had, like supplying the new warming center or adopt a teacher or something, wonder if they could be part of the monthly thing that we sometimes do, like today, this month was the Hope Center. Some of these things could be done ahead of time, and they could be on a monthly thing in the month of August or the month of July. We could support one of those particular places.
Thank you, Steve.
Hi, I'm back.
Okay.
We used to have an SI service, so the people from SI could tell the other people what a great thing it is. I think we should bring that back.
I think that's right.
Okay. So we got one more.
One more. Part of the reading today talked about how we're all teachers and learners. And I'm just thinking about the youth because that's kind of where my head goes. We're always telling the youth about things, you know, about our traditions, about whatever. Wouldn't it be great if they
would tell us?
You know, they had a service, just the youth, that either they would have a service or they would have lead a discussion group about things that are important to them. They are not blind. They know the kind of things going on in our world, and be lovely to hear their perspective and see how we can support them.
Now, you guys knocked it out of the park this time. Give yourselves a hand. Good job, good suggestions, your thinking, and our community is already strong and this can just strengthen it. So again, all of these suggestions I will put together in one document. I will get them to not only the committees that may need them, but I'll give them to all the committees actually. And someone else wanted to have them sent to everyone. And that way, if you wanted to head one up, all you have to do is let us know, okay? Because that would be great to have folks step up and do one of these projects. Another thing someone told me just prior to the service was they would like to see Coffee House come back. So I think a lot of us would like to see Coffee House come back. So hopefully we can make that happen this fall with the music committee's help. Okay. Now these things aren't going to happen all at once. You know, no change happens quickly, whether it's in history or in UU congregations. We usually have to talk about it for a bit and get it to the right committee and go from there. Your help with these things would be advantageous to spearhead. Building our community and keeping it strong is so very, very important. For a lot of us, this is our support system. We don't have family really in the area that function well in that capacity. But you folks do. We're like-minded, we understand one another, we care about one another, we've been together for a long time. And any of the new folks come in, we need to include those right away into our little folds. It's very important. Keeping a congregation strong keeps a congregation healthy, it keeps it vibrant, it keeps it growing. Blessed be. Now, our closing hymn would be 323, Break Not the Circle. Benediction comes from Reverend Pat Uribe Leike. We come from places along different paths, bringing different truths. We come with different histories and different realities, and yet we come together as one people with faith that we can use our differences to heal ourselves and to heal each other, to bring wholeness to a fractured world. We come seeking to find community, to find acceptance for who we are. In this place, may we find others who are much like us and others who are much different. May our lit chalice remind us that we are people taught by different stories with many, many voices, but always one people working for a world where love creates justice and justice gives birth to peace. And before the chalice is extinguished, I do have one announcement. You don't have to see me next week. We are going to have a guest minister in the pulpit next week. Some of you know her. So live and in person at Strawn Hall, the Reverend Dr. Elaine Strawn will come back and honor us with service. If you cannot join us here at the fellowship, please join us via YouTube, and let's wave to all those folks. We didn't wave to them yet today. Hello, folks. Join us via YouTube, and we will see you all next Sunday.